This is an opportunity to take advantage of this and be able to somehow create money or get in the game for your family's future. What's up, everyone? Jeff Koga here, and welcome to Jeff Koga Live. And this episode will be streamed at a podcast, and it's going to be called Los Angeles Housing Market Update, and Will Fannie Mae's Recent Move Skyrocket the Real Estate Market? Now, why do I want to talk about that is recently Fannie Mae made an update to kind of inject the real estate market with a move. I knew this move was on the blocks for a while, and I'll talk about why I knew this and what the impacts of this is, as well as what it exactly it is. I'll give my thoughts on it, and then I'll talk about how the real estate market will go up, go down, or whatever it is, and even a conversation from a mastermind group that I have, where we have about 14,000 real estate professionals, and I had them chime in on Fannie Mae's recent move. So what am I talking about when I say Fannie Mae's recent move? So Fannie Mae announced that they're going to now allow anyone with student loan to kind of say, hey, this loan payment that you've been making, you don't have to consider that loan payment for your student loan part of your expense. Meaning you can say that, hey, someone else is paying for it. All right. Meaning that your debt to income ratio will literally come down. Okay. Meaning your debt, they're going to exclude the debt, they're going to exclude the expenses. So it's going to come down. Meaning you can buy more real estate. Okay. Meaning you can qualify for a higher loan. And because you can qualify for a higher loan, you're going to say, hey, your $200, $300, $400, $500 a month that you've been paying on your student loan, hey, don't worry about it. It's not considered an expense. And because of that, now that income that you've been using to pay the student loan, you know, hey, will allow you to qualify for a higher loan. Okay, I hope that made sense. If it doesn't, leave a comment below somewhere and I can explain a little bit, because I'd rather talk about more of the implication of this policy versus kind of the fundamental thing when it comes to qualifying for a loan, which is really easy to just Google and you can find out. But if you have questions, leave it in a comment. Okay, so what does this do? All right, now first off, this country is all based on bubbles. It's called the bubble economy. And if there's a book called, I believe, called Bubble Economy, pick it up and read it. It was written in 2010. If you pull it up on Amazon, I think it's one of the highest reviews. And they talk about how capitalism and globalization, they talk about how the central banks and the government have to create bubbles so that way they can go ahead and sustain the large entity that it has kind of now become. Okay, now, regardless if you believe that, hey, you know what, more debt is the solution or not, because that's what really the core of it boils down to, right? Is more debt the solution to help kind of the millennial generation who has a lot of student loan to be able to become homeowners, to chase that American dream of actually owning a house? That's the real fundamental question here, okay? And my answer is more debt is not the answer. But what you can't do as an individual level, okay, is one, you can disagree with it, all right? But if the rules are the rules, you just gotta play by the rules, and you can't blame the people who are setting the rules, right? Because there is a moral obligation that always falls down to at the individual level, where they have to take responsibility of what they're doing, okay? Like, for example, I talked about this a lot on the last real estate crisis that we had, when we had the crash, the last real estate market crash, right? I talked about this a lot, where who do you actually blame, right? Do you blame the person that actually took out these exotic loans, or maybe used their house as an ATM, kept on refinancing, taking out money from their house, and they were using it to pay bills, or they were using it to actually go on vacation, they were using it to pay for their kids' tuition, they were using it for retirement, whatever they were using it for, right? They're taking this money out of their house, using it as an ATM, and then suddenly the real estate value comes down, or the exotic loan that they had adjust in terms of mortgage payments, and then suddenly they can't afford it, and then boom, they're blaming the actual federal government and says, hey, you know what, I was actually conned into this type of loan. Right now, Were there some fraud going on? Yeah, but it's a very small percentage at the end of the day. I'll tell you this, okay? In terms of volume of loans that came out and people that really got defrauded, it's a very small percentage, ladies and gentlemen, okay? But the news like to play that up. I'm a firm believer that the individuals have to take responsibility of their own action. Now, you as a homeowner being naive to the type of loan that you're taking out and thinking that, hey, you know what? I took out a $500,000 loan and my mortgage payment is $1,000, right? And thinking that nothing bad is gonna happen, you know, you're lying to yourself, and you still have to take responsibility for it, right? And I'm not saying this again from coming from an ivory tower says, look, I wasn't impacted by it. I was probably one of those idiots who took out those type of loans, okay? Matter of fact, I got into the game because of those exotic loans in the real estate business. I bought my first house as 19 doing an 80-20 type of loan. It's called the 80-20 loan, and it was 100% finance, meaning I did not bring any money to the closing table, and I was able to buy a house because of that type of loan, okay? Now, if you know the rules and then know the rule that this rule is now happening, okay, then the question is, what are you gonna do with it? Are you gonna be on the sideline and be upset that actually the taxpayer entity is there to physically, you're paying money, because someone's gonna, you know, if it defaults, someone's paying for it, and that someone is, guess what, the taxpayer, okay? So you can be upset about it, and or you can be like, okay, this is an opportunity to take advantage of this and be able to somehow create money or get in the game for your family's future. Okay, and that's the only way I believe you can do it, because again, trust me, right? The news is gonna pick this up. If you watch the ordinary news, they're gonna start talking about if it's a good, it's a bad, right? Because this thing was just released. And if you're listening to this later on, let me know if you actually hear a lot about this. Again, you know, do you get upset because there's a new policy and because lending is becoming easier and people are now able to take out more easier loans to buy a house? Do you get upset at those people, or do you get upset at the people that actually don't know what to do and they're over leveraging themselves, right? Because if you know this and this exists, right, now you can use this to multiple things, okay? First, I'll apply as kind of people in the real estate sales industry or real estate investors and how you can actually use this. And then I'll talk about kind of the other people on where they should be if you remotely even think about buying a house and what it'll actually do. Because I believe with this, the real estate market is going to take off even more. So what's the implication of this, right? So if you're in the sales industry and or if you're a real estate investor, one, if you're in the sales industry, there is a whole group of generations that thought that they couldn't qualify for a loan because of their student loans. That's number one, okay? And because of that, now they have the ability to physically have a potential to buy. So if you're doing loans, it's a great thing to use this as a hook to get applications. Get a lot of applications, use this as a hook. Get them in the funnel, right? Get them on the phones and then see what they qualify for. Now, these people that you're actually having qualify, it may not be just, okay, I'll say this again. It may not just be, because people think that, hey, it's just like these broke millennials that don't have money and you're saving them and you're making them homeowners. No, right? If they're broke, they shouldn't be a homeowner. Right? But what if they're high earning income professionals like a doctor, right? And like a doctor, they have high income, but they have a ginormous student loan of $100,000, $200,000, and then they're paying a lot on it, all right? Their earning potential is high. So if you can give them a little bit of slack on this so they can go buy a house, it can allow them, one, to help them out to get into the game. All right, and then if they're smart, that high earning income person that has a, you know, big student loan and they're paying, you know, let's just say $100,000 and they're paying $1,000 a month on this student loan. Let's just say I'm using that as an example, okay? And now they don't have to use it in their calculation of what they call debt to income ratio, okay, or DTI. Then in that case, that individual should be smart. And if you're in the sales industry, okay, or you're in an investor, okay, you should advise these individuals to say, hey, maybe you should buy rentals with these. Maybe you should actually go buy a property that you can rent out and you can get income from, all right? And that income that you can get, guess what? Now covers your student loan, right? Now, if you can do that, woo, I'm telling you, it's gonna help the real estate market. Because the worst thing in a market, all right, for anyone who has ever traded stocks is a place called a consolidation phase. Right, where the market is just flat. When a market is just flat, it just sucks. It just sucks for everyone, right? Because there's no action. At least if it's going up, right, you can make money, right? If it's going down, you can make money. But when it's flat, it's a little bit harder because you don't know which way it goes. So right now, it's been kind of flat the last 12 to 18 months. So I rather see it go up. okay? All right, or go down. It doesn't really matter what it is, but the point of matter is this, is that you got to get it out of the consolidation phase. And I believe that's what the government is doing, because the government knows this country, United States of America, is ran on the engines of bubbles, and that bubble currently right now that they are building is the real estate market, okay? Why? Is because they have pumped the equity market up, and you know, we broke 20,000 on the Dow Jones, okay? And it'll be really, really interesting on what's gonna happen. If the equities market crashes, then guess what? I'm a firm believer it'll be back like 1999, 2000, when the dot-com bubble busted, and the people who have money in the stock market will be like, oh my gosh, let me take it out of the stock market, the equities market, and let me bring it back into real estate. And we know those are the only two asset classes that you can put into, or, well, there's actually three, right? Government bonds or treasuries you can put it into, real estate, right? Or equities, and those are only about the most three traditional type of asset classes that you have. And treasuries, they don't really pay out, right? So you're not gonna use that. So guess what? You're left with equities and real estate, okay? So if both currently right now is going up, so if one comes down, and one that is a lot easier to come down is the equities market, because it's a more liquid asset, then when it comes down, it's gonna come back into the real estate market. So pay attention to it. I'll link down somewhere, or somewhere in the notes of wherever you watch this, there'll be a section too, so you can read about the article, okay? I'm giving kind of the high level, 10,000, 30,000 foot view on what this does. And again, you can be upset about it. It really doesn't matter. You can be upset. You can disagree with the rules. But the bottom line is, you got to play by the rules and win the game. That's all that really matters, ladies and gentlemen, because as I posted this in the mastermind group, right, about the update of what's going on with our beautiful quasi, government entity, right, and it'll be really interesting to see the other ones actually come out, Sallie Mae, right, Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, right, regardless of what it is, okay, they're going to loosen up lending. They are going to absolutely loosen up the lending side, because they have to go ahead and create this bubble. Okay, they have to. So if you're going to partake in it, then figure out a way to actually make money from it. All right. And the reason why I knew this was going to happen, okay, in terms of, to help out the millennials that have a bunch of student loan debt, right, to get into the housing market, is because my brother is a portfolio manager for the biggest collection agencies in the United States. And guess what? He managed the portfolio. They're contracted by, guess what? The Department of Education, okay? They hold a contract for Department of Education and other guarantors. Now, what do I mean by other guarantors? Is kind of like the states, right? The states that give out student loans, they collect on that loan. So he gives me kind of the quote unquote other side broke millennials that have student loans. But here's the interesting fact, okay? I'll tell you this, okay? People think that it's actually the millennials that have this ginormous amount of student loan debt, but really, there is a really, really true dark side. It's not just the millennials, okay? It's the people in their 40s, 50s, and even 60-year-olds that have student loans. Why? Is because they lost a job because they were doing an industry that was dying or something like that, or they convinced themselves that they have to actually go to this school, and then they go to these specialty schools, right? And then they take it out and they never finish. And these are some of the people that have student loans. All right. And these people are trying to make payments, but really they can't get out because they have what? They have a family, they have kids, right? And they have these loans, and they're falling behind. Okay. And they have to clean that out. And what most individuals are not aware of is, it's a crazy stuff, is that student loans is the only debt that you can't wipe out in a bankruptcy. Everything else you can wipe out. Okay. Mortgages, you can wipe out. Credit card debt, you can wipe out. Okay. Student loans, you cannot wipe out in a bankruptcy. All right. The federal government wants your money. Okay. You cannot wipe it out. All right. So it's a huge, huge issue on that. So the federal government has started to try to fight this huge student loan debt bubble by allowing individuals to work for the government. Okay. Basically becoming indentured servant. Right. So in the back in the days, when you work for something for X amount of years, and then they wipe out your debt. Right. So they have those types of program. And again, I started off this, kind of podcast episode and this video where I talked about the responsibility always goes back to the individual, because the individual has to be responsible and play by the rules. And not only play by the rules, but if you're smart, you're going to win. So for example, right, you hear that and says, oh my gosh, the taxpayer money is going towards people wiping out their debt just because they work for the government. Yes. What are you going to do? You're going to say, hey, you know, F it, and you're going to fight it while it exists, okay? And it has been existing for a while, you know? Other things are like GI bills or something like that, right? For military people, that actually exists. Yeah, they have to pay a little bit for it, but it still exists. So for example, people who are smart, like I have a friend that I know who is a doctor, went to prestigious medical school. They graduated, have over $250,000 in student loan debt, and guess what they did? They joined the military, all right? Because they wanted to join the military? Heck no. They didn't want to join the military. They didn't say, hey, I wanted to be a doctor and join the military. No, they joined the military so they can actually put in their time. And once you go past that, then guess what? They wipe out the actual student loan. You don't got to pay anything back, right? So again, play by the rules. Doesn't matter who's at fault. I'm a firm believer. Be a capitalist. Learn how to make money in whatever industry that you're in, and learn how you can capitalize this for your advantage, and then see how you can grow your personal wealth, and so that way you can leave a legacy for your family and the people that love you and your friends around you, right? So that's what I got. I got to go in. I'm running late today, and I'll talk about some couple other stuff later on, but that's my little Los Angeles housing market, because I'm a firm believer that the real estate market as an interesting crossroads, and the more and more policies I'm paying attention to on what's coming out, I think the real estate market, we're going entering into another golden age, ladies and gentlemen, another golden age. And it's exciting if you do some of the right stuff. That's what I got. Take care. Bye-bye.